Hey guys, Dr. Mike Israetel here for Renaissance Plus. Topic of the day is training trade-offs. A pretty theoretical topic that I want you guys to give some thought because it has a lot of applications, not just to making your training better, but even choosing your direction in training. So, starts out with goal setting. The first question of any training endeavor is, what do you want to get better at? Right? As soon as you figure out what you want to get better at, let's say it's building muscle. Let's say it's improving the endurance in your legs. Let's say it's working on your snatch technique. Whatever you want to improve, there is necessarily an optimal way to go about improving it. Now, we may not know or be able to properly execute the 100% optimal, but it's out there. Somewhere in the universe, there exists an optimal way to train for a particular thing. Every piece of your training is going to line up exactly at parts of the puzzle to fit in, to perfectly arrange that exact direction to make you as good as you possibly could have been. So there's that theoretical optimum way to train for anything that you want to get better at. But now let's ask another question. What if we want to get better at two things? Almost by definition, we can get better at those two things, but we have to split our resources between them, right? And this is in every and any endeavor you can think of. You will always get better at one thing versus any two things. It'll be easier to get better at one thing than any two things because of all the resources you have to give to one thing, if it's now two things that you have to get better at, you're going to have to split those resources up. Now, there may be some good crossover or cross-potentiation effect from those two things, but it's unlikely to be perfect crossover. So for example, if you want to get good at both writing very detailed handwriting or drawing pictures, some of the same training for fine movements of the wrist is going to cross over and make you better at both. But at some point, especially when you get more advanced than either one of them, the particular calligraphy strokes are going to be quite different from painting strokes. And one hour spent doing one is an hour you could have spent doing the other. It's adaptations of the nervous system that could have gone in one direction or the other. Because we're always working with finite resources and training, we're always in a situation where if we want to get better at one thing, we know exactly the path by which to do it. As soon as we have to get better at two things or more, we know that the potential to improve in either one of them isn't going to be as high. And it's just a matter of fact. It's not a particularly scary thing. It just probably, to you guys listening, probably sounds pretty obvious, which is good because it's the start of our big, longer conversation. Now, we mentioned some carryover before. So if you learn how to paint with a broad stroke brush versus fine calligraphy, some of the same ways of moving your hand, some of the same ways of detail orienting, of planning a drawing, of executing it, both still apply. Both of them have a carryover effect on each other. Getting good at one makes you a little better at the other. Maybe not perfectly well, but we can't say they're just two completely distinct things. Doing them gives you some kind of crossover effect so that doing one is at least something to improve the other and it's not a total loss. With the main fitness characteristics of executing sport, there is some degree of crossover between all of them. All of the ways to get fit crossover, but some crossover much more than others. Got a quick list for you, and then we'll talk about which ones carry over or cross over more to which other ones. Training for speed, which also includes maximum velocity at takeoff, which means jump height as well. All right? Training for speed, which can be running speed, speed with a bar, what have you. Training for power, which is the generation of high forces at maximum velocities, something like a snatch or a clean and jerk, for example. Training for strength, the ability to generate high forces for a single repetition, training for size, right, just getting bigger, and training for endurance. All of those are different goals, and they have a different degree of crossover. And the way in which I listed them is the degree of crossover that they have. So for example, if you are training for speed purely, how much better will you get at power training just by training for speed? And the way we answer that is we ask, what are the underlying physical systems and nervous system components that make you better at speed, but also at power? What does it take to be fast? It takes the development of fast twitch muscle fibers. It takes a nervous system that can explode really quickly on command. It doesn't require much endurance, and it generally requires that you execute things in a fluid athletic pattern. Well, definitely applies to speed, and almost all that applies to power as well. The only real difference is power relies significantly more on high forces versus high velocities. So it relies kind of on a combination of both, where a speed may use high forces to generate high velocities, but it doesn't use force for its own sake. Power can. So if you're training for power and you don't worry about speed at all, the next question is, how fast are you going to be if you just train for power? The answer is, you're going to get a lot of speed. The only potential downside is to gain all that force ability, you might hypertrophy your muscle fibers to go for pure power, force times velocity, right? How much you can clean and jerk. You might hypertrophy your muscle fibers so much, their maximum velocity of movements, because your limbs are now heavier, might decrease, but the force production increases so much, the multiplier of that power goes up to its highest of all time. But your velocity might have been higher had you not hypertrophied your muscle fibers to the same extent. For example, a super heavyweight weightlifter is the most powerful of all weightlifters. They can generate the most power because they can lift those high loads at high velocities. But the way they get there is maintaining their velocities or keeping them at very high levels, but increasing how much force they can generate, not usually the other way around. So a super heavyweight lifter, are they really quick and explosive? More than you could ever imagine until you see it in real life. But are they the fastest they could have been if they kept their cross-sectional area of their muscle size down so as not to get weighed down for movements? No, so they're not going to be as fast as some others. So there's a lot of crossover between speed and power, but there's already a bit of a difference. Next, we go to strength. So what is the carryover from speed to strength? Well, you still need to generate a lot of force, but strength doesn't necessarily have to generate it in any rapid time, right? So if we train just to get stronger, we're going to be able to push off the ground really hard or push into a bar really hard to potentially generate speed. But at the same time, we're not necessarily working on the nervous system and the coordination characteristics to maximize velocity. We have the force to back it up, but we don't really care how fast that bar moves. And when we're training for strength, we're going to be training so heavy, the resulting movement is going to be very slow, even though we're trying to push hard. And that practice with even a resulting slow movement gets to used to coordinating your limbs at a relatively slow rate. So there's a technique and nervous system component slightly missing to generate speed when you're training for strength. And of course, training for strength, you're ultimately going to get so much bigger because cross-sectional area of muscle is so important to strength, you're not going to be your fastest. Strength and power relate incredibly well to each other, but remember, power has a lot of strength component, but also a speed component. So that speed component is going to be slightly missing. So if you're just training for strength, will you get more powerful? Absolutely. Will you get faster? Maybe. Usually, but if you're already at a high level of strength, getting much stronger probably won't make you much faster. You'd have to change the nervous system and the technique training for speed and maybe even drop some weight to get much faster. So we can already see between speed and power, not such a great difference. Really big overlap in training because the same underlying subsystems are being trained. With power and strength, again, a really big overlap, but with speed and strength, smaller overlap. So we're already seeing a differentiation that if we want to be the fastest and the strongest person of all time, we might meet in the middle and just be the most powerful because that's kind of the even trade-off of the two, speed times strength. But we're not going to be probably the best at either one of those because time spent on sprint training or speed development can be spent just getting stronger. And we'll get into more of exactly what the underlying mechanisms are for why those differences occur, why we can't be good at everything else. How about size? You can ask yourself a question. It's a really easy question, actually. Who can jump higher, move quicker, and sprint for 10 meters faster? A weightlifter who's a power athlete? A powerlifter who's a strength athlete? And our next variable is size, a bodybuilder who is a size athlete. Now, some literature has been done on this, quite a bit, actually, and it's shown that power athletes, weightlifters and throwers, who are just as big as bodybuilders, they weigh just as much, and they even have higher body fats, they move the quickest of all of the non-speed-specific athletes, sprinters, etc. They're really fast because they train power, and power has a big speed component. Power lifters and strongmen, are pretty fast. They're not very unathletic or not super quick at all, because they train, they have so much strength, they can push off the ground really hard, push an implement really hard, but the nervous system characteristics and the technique's not exactly there to maximize their speed. So they're pretty fast. Bodybuilders are the slowest of all the strength athletes. Why? Because they're training for size. Now, how many links down the chain does size contribute to speed? Well, muscle size has to make more muscle strength. Muscle strength has to create more power, and then power has to create more speed. That's a couple links away, and there's ways for fitness characteristics to leak out of that transitional stage. Here's an example. The optimal kind of training for size gets you bigger, but it's not the kind of training that alters the nervous system to make you as strong as possible per that unit of cross-sectional area. So bodybuilders, the very way they get big is relatively higher reps and more volume. That higher level of volume and those higher reps teach the nervous system to move for reps, not explosively. And the nervous system, as we'll learn in a bit, can only do one thing perfectly and everything else is a slight trade-off. So if we have our nervous system and we have our musculature designed to exert itself over some units of time, and even the fiber types that are trained are different at this point, we're not going to see this enormous carryover from size to strength or the other way around. So if you train for speed, you're not going to see a huge gain in hypertrophy because we're now dealing at relatively opposite ends of the spectrum. Now, some size is necessary to speed and vice versa. However, there's a big difference between the two. So if you wanted to become the ultimate speed and power athlete, you could have done a pretty good job at it. Maybe not the ultimate, but you would have been very fast and very powerful. If you wanted to become the ultimate speed and strength athlete, both, oh, you could have done a pretty good job. Just training for power basically would have gotten you very powerful and thus pretty fast and pretty strong. Not the best at either one of those, but decent. Certainly you could have been a better speed power athlete. Now, if you want to be the best speed size athlete, boy, do you have a hill to climb. And another problem with this hill is that the bigger you get, the better it is for size. But the bigger you get, the lower your power to weight ratio and thus your speed gets. It's easy to be fast when you weigh 190 pounds as a running back or wide receiver. When you get up to weighing, you know, 320 or 330 pounds as an offensive lineman, you may have all the genetics to be fast. You may have the limb ratios, you may have the fiber types, you may have the nervous system characteristics. Hauling that much weight simply won't let you be your fastest possible. Lastly, on this list of sort of countervailing training approaches is endurance. How does endurance relate to speed training? Well, the nervous system characteristics of endurance are literally opposite to those of speed. When you train for speed, your nervous system is literally being trained to explode once, twice, three, four, five, six times, and then just get super tired because you always get a lot of rest. It's going to use all of its resources to produce a ton of force right there and then, at the highest rates of force development. On the other hand, for endurance, you're literally teaching your nervous system to dope out very tiny amounts of force, very tiny amounts of effort over minutes and hours. So the nervous system isn't going to be optimal at either one of those, and it's going to result in being either good at one, really good at the other, or somewhere in between, which isn't going to be very amazing at both. In addition to that, the muscle fiber types required for endurance are usually slower twitch muscle fibers with lots of vascularization to bring a lot of blood to the area and a lot of blood back to transport oxygen and nutrients and to transport waste products and carbon dioxide away. Those are different, very different kind of muscle fibers that are more fast twitch. They're not very well vascularized. They're not very fatigue resistant. And even what's inside the muscles is different, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. So just about the only thing that endurance athletes and speed athletes that are dedicated have in common, well, they're both human, that's a good start, and they're both lean. Because when you're lean and you have low body fat, you can both go for long distances and produce a ton of force or produce a ton of speed at once because you're not weighed down. Other than being lean, the training approaches and the kinds of training that maximize everything really don't have a ton in common between endurance and speed. We'll talk about in just a second how those two adaptations actually fight each other in the human body, and you can only have so much of one or so much of the other. So when we're looking at speed and power, there's a lot of overlap and just a little bit of you could be doing one better or the other better. When we talk about speed and strength, there's considerable overlap or a considerable difference. We talk about size and speed, there's a lot of difference. When you talk about endurance and speed, man, it's everything minus just being generally fit and having low body fat, it's probably best you do it one way versus the other, right? So the further apart these two, the two things we're training are on the list, the least help they give each other if they're trained simultaneously and the more resistance they give each other. So when you're arranging your training program, it's good to keep that in mind. Before we talk about that, let's talk about why exactly, and we've hinted at a lot of these, is there such competition between adaptive demands. Why can't you just get better at everything? It goes all the way down to the muscle cell. And actually, it goes even lower than that. Per unit. So, you know what? I had on my little list here that I'm referencing to, the muscle cell. I can go even one deeper. Actin and myosin. Myosin pulls on actin to pull it closer together into the muscle cell to generate contraction. The kind of myosin that you have, literally, the actual design of the molecule, differs between faster twitch muscle fibers and slower twitch muscle fibers. And it's called the type of myosin heavy chain that you have. There are different kinds of myosin molecules. Some of them consume ATP, or fuel, at a very steady but low rate, and they contract with some little bit of force, and every now and again, and they don't produce a ton of really rapid contractions to bring the muscle together. Those are more slow twitch kind. The more fast twitch kind of actual literal molecular myosin heads consume a great amount of ATP, and they cycle through really fast and they pull super hard. That's all the way down to the single molecule. So if you have a lot of really fast twitch muscle fibers, you probably have a lot of myosin heavy chain heads that are very, very, very prone to generating tons of forces rapidly. All the way down to the molecular differences is where we see abilities of endurance versus speed, for example, and everything in between. So, okay, the myosin heavy chains are different. What's next? We zoom out to the level of the cell. Every muscle cell that we have, remember, we're already talking about lean individuals, so we're not worried about fat. Everyone, basically, we can say has the same amount of muscle in our little comparison group. So say, okay, same amount of muscle, that's really good. They should have all the same abilities, but not so fast. We got a muscle cell of a certain size. This is all the muscle we have, right? That cell, we can fill it with any wide variety of things that help one process but not another. So for example, if we fill our cell, typically fast twitch cells are built like this, with lots of contractile proteins, lots of actin myosin, the force generating capacity is massive. On the other hand, where are we getting all the ATP, all the fuel, to keep going to keep that fuel? Well, mitochondria produces most of our ATP for long duration activities. But if we fill our cell with contractile elements, actin, myosin, sarcomeres, we don't have much room for mitochondria. So we put a little mitochondria here and there, automatically it's a fast twitch cell that isn't going to have very high endurance. Let's say we want high endurance. We have to literally reduce the number of sarcomeres per cell, thus reducing how much force we can produce for the same amount of muscle and how rapidly that muscle contracts. Now we have more mitochondria, we can go for much longer. But you see, the literal physical organelle of mitochondria had to replace other organelles of sarcomeres, of contractile units. It's one or the other. You can't have both unless you make the muscle even bigger. But of course, if you make a muscle infinitely big, you get neither speed nor endurance. So now we're back to a real big problem, right? So it's one or the other. There's only so much space in the cell. And we can add in a third organelle just as an example. The sarcoplasmic reticulum, the SR, actually has calcium that it releases to allow this whole contraction process to occur. For especially kind of intermediate distance events, running a 400, doing 20 rep squats, your sarcoplasmic reticulum has to be really big, really well developed to release a ton of calcium over and over and over and over. Because if you have slow twitch muscle fibers, your SR doesn't have to be super developed. So you only need a little bit of calcium because there's not a ton of contractile elements. Remember, it's a lot of mitochondria and a little bit of contractile elements. We have a huge army of contractile machinery and you want it to operate more than one or two times, 1 or 2 seconds, then you've got to have a huge dominant sarcoplasmic reticulum. That's another organelle that fills in a lot of muscle space that you could have used for either super fast twitch fibers that would have had just very little SR but a ton of contractile machinery, very low endurance but a ton of strength and power. If we want to go for the intermediate, we have a big sarcoplasmic machine and a little bit of mitochondria here and there and some other contractile elements to fill that out, kind of a one-third approach. Then we have a pretty decent at everything, but not exceptional at anything. And if we fill our muscle with a lot of mitochondria and very small, slow twitch sarcomeres that actually produce force and a minimally sized sarcoplasmic reticulum, what we end up getting is a very good endurance adapted muscle, but that's not going to ever be very, very big or very strong or generate, even per its own cross-sectional area, a whole lot of force. So even at the cellular level, we're talking about that if you're really, really, really going to be as good as you can at one thing, you can't be the best you possibly could at another, right? Second concern, we already hinted at this, the body can only have so much muscle, right? And of that muscle that it has, only a certain amount can be faster twitch or slower twitch or more intermediate twitch. And if more of it is faster twitch, less of it by definition has to be slower twitch or intermediate twitch and vice versa, right? And those ratios will affect performance. Almost everyone who runs in the Olympics at the 100 meter dash is something like 70 or 80% fast twitch muscle fiber. Their legs, when biopsied, are mostly fast twitch. That means that most of the people that line up to run a 100 meter race, at the Olympics, the Olympic runners usually have, if they try to run the mile, literally just the mile, can't break 8 minutes in the mile. 8 minutes in the mile is considered a decent time for a middle school student. That's when you know you're fundamentally in pretty good shape. These people are Olympic class, yes, but for sprinting, they have such stacked cells of so little mitochondria, so much fast twitch muscle, that they generate so much fatigue and so much lactate buildup they can't clear or use in the mitochondria because they have poor circulation in that area where the capillary density is very low. They're designed for short effort, very high intensity, super high power and force, and not for endurance, right? And if their muscle was to be completely transformed to slow twitch, they still have the same amount of muscle, but they ran into the problem that they're not very good sprinters anymore, but they're very good endurance athletes. It's got to go one way or the other. There's always a trade-off, right? Because we're dealing with the same amount of muscle. You say, okay, but hold on. Why don't we just grow more muscle? Totally works, and you can improve all of your abilities growing more muscle to a point. And that point is your sport or your event's power-to-weight ratio limit. So some sports have some different power-to-weight ratios. So for a strongman, they don't have to have a very high power-to-weight ratio because the implements are so heavy. Maximum force is really what's going to be taxing the athlete. He has to just be huge to be able to do it. An endurance athlete has to exert his or her body for so long that if they're too heavy, even if it's with muscle, their endurance over the long term won't be sustainable. So if you want to be incredibly fast and incredibly endurant, and you're at average height for a male, maybe 5'10", you might be anywhere between 150 to 180 pounds. If you exit either one of those as far as muscle, and there's probably an optimal based on your body somewhere in between there, if you get too much muscle, you say, okay, fast twitch does this, slow twitch does that, I'm just going to add them both, right? An intermediate twitch, why not? You're going to at some point exit past 180. Your power to weight ratio won't be good for those sports you're doing anymore, and while you'll be very capable in your own regard, maybe with repetitions in the gym, you won't be able to move your own body around like you're supposed to. You can't just infinitely add muscle without affecting power to weight ratio. Never mind the fact you can't keep infinitely add muscle anyway. At some point, adding muscle becomes so hard that it's not worth your time anymore to keep trying to add it, right? So you just do better at more sport training. In addition to that, and this is starting to sound pretty bad here, right? These are compounding effects. The nervous system only has a finite ability to adapt. We already mentioned this before, so we're not going to get into it too much, but here's the deal. If your nervous system in your ability to exert athletic moves is prime, fine-tuned for explosion, it's going to be amazing at that and not so good at endurance. On the other hand, if it's fine-tuned to be an endurance machine, to dope out just a little bit of contraction machinery every single time to make sure you don't get fatigued, it's going to be really, really good at that and not the best at explosion. Explosion is a learned skill made of neural circuitry in your brain, and your brain has dedicated subsystems for basically everything it does. You can't get infinitely good at 50,000 different things. Your brain has limits. If you invest your literal mental machinery into being good at one thing, it's not going to be the best thing in the world for you to get good at another. So even our nervous system limits us when we're able to have the muscles that we want and the physiology that we want. The nervous system is again another limit saying, look, if you want to be the fastest human on the planet or the fastest you can be, your nervous system has to be tailored for that. And if you want to be fast and endurant at the same time, it's going to have to come from one or the other. You can't be the best of both worlds, right? Because it's one physical machine that operates. It's almost like saying, I want a race car that's also the world's best tractor. Well, a tractor has a completely different setup than a race car. And it's a setup in such a way that, you know, when you generate more torque and less torque, it's going to mean the wheel spin is going to be different. And a tractor is really good at moving big wheels slow and pulling very heavy things. But the very fact that it has big wheels that move slow make it very slow. And a race car has very small wheels that move very fast, which is amazing for acceleration, speed, and change of direction. But by definition, it can't pull on anything very heavy. Just the same way the nervous system and the physiology and the muscular system can only be optimally designed for one thing, and everything else is a derivation off of that that makes you a little bit not as good as you could have been at whatever you wanted, right? So if you want the optimal race car tractor, maybe what you can do is have a tractor that's a little bit more aerodynamic, has a really, really big engine, because that's good for everything, right? Has kind of intermediate-sized wheels, and now it's a pretty decent tractor, not amazing, and a pretty decent race car, not amazing. But if you think you can have the best of both worlds, you're really looking at magic here, or like the Transformers TV show or something like that. Lastly, all the physiology aside, there's the MRV problem, okay? When you're training for sport, you have a maximum recoverable volume past which any more training is going to make you worse and not better. So you have a certain amount of training and you have to recover from that training. Anytime you do some training that is for something, let's say endurance. The other training you have left for speed work. But hold on. If you took away the endurance, you could have done more speed work. You say, okay, but maybe I can do both and still recover okay. You could have recovered even better if you had eliminated the endurance work, done only the speed work that you needed, and then taken the rest of the time, instead of cramming endurance into there, to recover. So the fundamental fact, put in very plain terms, is this. For anything that you train, if you want to train something else, two things come up. Instead of training that something else, you could have, first of all, trained more of that thing you really want to get good at. So if you want to train for endurance and speed, but you really value speed much more, say, should I train for endurance as well? Maybe not, because instead of training for endurance, you could have simply done more speed work, gotten better. Or if you're already doing as much speed work as you can, you might have taken more rest, more recovery, been fresher, and gotten better because of more gains during the adaptation process that occurs with recovery. Kind of putting us in a little bit of a hole here. Now, mind you, there are ways around this. There are ways to modify this, which we'll talk about in a second. But the fundamental reality is this is a constrained process. If you want to get amazing at any one thing, automatically have to think about trade-offs. So let's get to those. Here's the question. Can you keep pushing everything to get better at everything? A lot of the individuals listening to this are going to be involved in the sport of CrossFit. That is a sport in which you want to try to get good at pretty much everything all at the same time. Maybe we'll talk about that also at the same time in just a sec. Can you get better at everything at the same time? Can you get better at everything in general? Yes, but it works much better in beginners than in advanced individuals. Okay. In advanced individuals, we have a little bit of an issue that comes up, right? The bad news, sort of, is that the minimum effective volume, the MEV, the minimum you have to do to get better for every subsystem goes up with training time. When you just start training, how many sets of five do you need to do in the bench press to get a stronger bench press? One set of five per week will work for literally about a month. Two sets of five for another couple of months, three sets of five for another, so on and so forth until you get to maybe 12 to 15 sets of five per week. And that's what it takes. Maybe, let's say, 10 or 8 sets of those is the minimum effective volume, right? Below 8 or 10 sets after a while, you just won't get much stronger. Above 8, 10 sets until you hit your MRV, you will get stronger. So when you're a beginner, your minimum effective volume for everything is really low. As you train for strength and for speed and for endurance, the minimum you have to do, because you're already so badass at all of those, the minimum you have to do to keep getting better keeps going up. But the good news is, the maintenance volume, the least you can get away with and still keep that ability around, doesn't really go up over time. It's actually pretty stable. And this is a common misconception, but people think elite athletes need to train super hard just to keep their gains. That's actually not true. They train just as easy as anyone else to keep their gains. So the reality is, right, you can use priority phases to continue to get good at everything, but you have to pick and choose your battles at picking and choosing your time. So what do we mean by that? If you try to train for speed, for strength, and for endurance all in the same month, your total MRV would be way exceeded. You literally can't train for all of them and do them due justice in that same unit of time. If we tried and we tried to cram them all in there, each one would come below its max, its minimum effective volume, its MEV, and it wouldn't be enough. So, for example, it takes 100 reps of bench press to make you stronger, and it takes, let's say, 150 meter sprints to make you faster, and it takes 100 miles a week to make you more endurant. But your total ability, right, to recover is, let's say, 200 total units. So let's say we have crammed in 100 here and 100 here. Well, we're both getting better, right? 100, 100 is 200. We're at least at our MAVs, right? But if we try to cram them all in there, we got to cut stuff off. We'll say we can only do 66 reps of bench. We can only do 66 miles and only 66 50 meter sprints to actually, two thirds or whatever, to actually cram them all in there for that to add up to 200. But hold on a second. The minimum effective volume, we said we had to do at least 100 reps, right? Or something like that. Maybe let's lower it for more realistic. Let's say at least 80 repetitions in the bench per week to get better at the bench. But now we're training at 66. We're wasting our time on every single one of these things. We're basically at maintenance volume for every single one of these things. That seems kind of backwards. That's when you try to train to so many different demands that you end up not getting better at anything. That's what's really going on, is by definition, you're below your minimum effective volume for all of them. That's like trying to be the best car mechanic, artist, painter, a hip-hop enthusiast, and professional chef all at the same time as your hobbies. If you try to do that many hobbies, unless you don't have a day job, you're not going to get better at anything. Everything's going to be confusing. You're going to get to a certain maintenance level of being okay and everything. Your friends will come back in a year and be like, hey man, how's your chef making? You know, how's your chef skills? You got any good recipes? You're like, man, you know what? I can only be a chef for a couple hours a day every week. I literally kind of maxed out my abilities. If I was going to be a better chef, I'd have to really invest some more time into it. Well, that's below your minimum effective volume for becoming a better chef. So how do we get around that? Well, remember, we said that maintenance volume is actually pretty low. It stays low, and we can maintain everything. We don't have to lose it. So here's how you do it. You pick one or two or three, depending on how many characteristics you have and what your total MRV is. You just take a couple of those. You train them at their between their minimum effective volume and their maximum recoverable volume. You give them due diligence, hard training, right? The other fitness characteristics you want to stick around, for example, endurance, you're going to put on the back burner. You're going to insert it into your MRV, into your total training plan, but only at its maintenance volume, so that you're not expecting it to get better. You're doing just enough so that it sticks around and doesn't get worse. So over the course of that several months of training, these two characteristics that you are training are getting better, and your endurance is staying the same. Once they get to here, you switch the script. You maybe keep one of them to train hard. The other one you drop down to maintenance, and you bring your endurance back up to minimum effective volume or higher. Now, okay, so there are these two. One of them is going to stick over here for you for the next couple of months. One of them is going to continue to rise, and your endurance is also going to rise. After that, after you've gotten your endurance up, you choose another one to de-emphasize, and you prioritize the other two. So it's literally taking two steps forward, zero steps back. Two steps forward and just waiting on a step for a second. That makes sense? So when it's not two steps forward, one step back, it's two steps forward and then we can't take another step forward for one of those modalities, right? That's how that sort of training looks. Now, in order to make that more logical structure, you have to use potentiated phases so that one phase helps the other and so on and so forth. That's a more advanced concept of periodization that Dr. Hoffman's gonna talk to you guys about. Generally speaking, the idea is if you want to get really, really good at a bunch of things, you don't always train all of them all at the same time. You're going to have phases of training, a couple of weeks here or a month here or a half a year here, where you push some of them, keep some on the back burner, and then you push these others and keep others on the back burner. That leapfrog action is the way you're going to be able to get much better at everything over time, or at least as good as you could be. Remember, this still comes at trade-offs. This doesn't get around the fact that we're going to be limited, but we can be less limited. We can exert the most influence on our bodies in all of the modalities we want to get good. Lastly, figure out and know what you want before embarking on program design or exercise selection or program selection. This also applies to dieting too. Figure out what you want to be good at. Know in your heart of hearts or your mind of minds what exactly you want out of your program. Once you know that, you can properly arrange the training variables or tell your coach that is programming for you to arrange them, and they or you will do a good job in getting you what you actually want, as opposed to something you don't want, right? They'll say, okay, well, your speed is improving. And you're like, I didn't really want to get faster, right? Or you're getting bigger. You're like, I didn't want to get bigger. I wanted to get faster, right? And also make sure that we're not missing out anything you did want to improve on, right? So we'll say, oh, you're getting bigger. And say, okay, well, am I getting faster? Well, no, we have no idea. We're supposed to make you faster. Know what you want and don't wobble too much, right? Because some people say, I want to get better at everything. And that's a fine concern. When you want to get better at everything, you have to understand that you are delimiting how much better you can get at everything because you have to rotate through those cycles much slower, right? You got a lot of stuff to put on maintenance, a lot of stuff to get through and put on the back burner and the front burner, right? So if you say, I want to get better at everything, don't expect rapid gains. So you can't say I want to get better at everything and be like, why isn't my benchmarks moving up like really, really super fast? Well, we got a little bit of an issue there, right? If a benchmarks moves up super fast, that's good. But if it doesn't, you have to understand that it's competing with, you know, five or six other general demands. If you say, okay, I only want a bigger bench and bigger muscles all over. I don't care about endurance for a time. I don't even want to put it on maintenance. I don't care about it at all. Well, we can make your bench much bigger than that. But now we're working with a more of a stacked deck to that arrangement. So before you ever go into programming or anything like that, figure out what you want so that whoever's programming for you, or if it's yourself, working with a clean slate to make sure you make the best arrangement of variables. Always keep those trade-offs in mind. Thanks for tuning in, folks. See you next time.